consensus guidelines are interesting, and so you know, I'll chat a little bit about that. I think what they do is probably three major things. I think number one, doing a consensus guideline, I think shows to the medical community that, yeah, we can work together. You know, as a community, can we sit down in a room, work together, look at the information, come up with best guidance based on what we have successfully, and kind of, I guess, agree, you know, and sometimes agree to disagree. The second thing that comes out of a consensus is, I think, obviously the purpose of it, right? What are the best ways to do diagnosis and treatment of GLUT1? And so we can know and pass on that information to parents, but it also tells us what we don't know. And I think that's the great part of a consensus guideline is, you know, what do we have absolutely no consensus on? Where actually we're almost at times arguing around the table, where we don't always agree about different topics. And then I think the third that comes out of it, and we did this for our ketogenic diet consensus, is that maybe in about 10 years you do it again. And you say, what's changed, right? 2020, what did we say? What did we think about GLUT1 deficiency? What about in 2030? It may be very, very different. And we'll see.
The typical symptoms for GLUT1 deficiency patients are funny eye head movements that do not represent a seizure but are abnormal, so parents get concerned and usually take a video and show it to their doctor. That's then followed by seizures, usually in the first half of year one, and then gradually developmental delay is observed, and then movement disorder, which can be quite complex, kicks in, which sort of can be either paroxysmal, meaning sudden events, or constant. And the combination of epilepsy plus a movement disorder plus impaired development should always trigger physicians to consider GLUT1 deficiency. We see that the phenotype, meaning the symptoms these patients have, is increasingly complex. We see very mildly affected patients, severely affected patients. For instance, speech, we've been discussing that there are patients that didn't develop any speech at all. Others are hardly impaired. You have patients that really have problems with seizures that cannot be treated sufficiently by the ketogenic diet. They need additional medication. And others who do not have seizures at all, but they have a movement disorder that's quite disabling or impairing life quality. So you have a very wide, broad spectrum. And within this spectrum, you find peculiar things, like you find migraine-like episodes, hemiplegia, you find stroke-like episodes, you find a whole bunch of symptoms that you wouldn't originally linked to GLUT1, but can be GLUT1. So what you need to do is you focus on the cardinal symptoms, and then any unexplained combination of movement disorder combined with developmental delay or maybe epilepsy that isn't diagnosed otherwise should receive the lumbar puncture for GLUT1 deficiency syndrome.
I've had the pleasure of working with several patients and families who are adults with GLUT1 deficiency syndrome. And what I have seen over the lifespan is that patients tend to present initially with seizure disorders, eye movements, and as they age, those change such that they begin to have fewer seizures, fortunately. However, they develop some very characteristic movements, such as paroxysmal, exertional dyskinesias, and dystonias that progress over the course of the lifespan. These patients can also develop difficulties with speech that evolve over time, and can also develop intellectual and developmental disabilities that either worsen over time or, in fact, in some cases, do improve.
To make a definitive diagnosis of GLUT1 deficiency syndrome, that sounds like an easy task, but it's very complex because as I say, the patients don't always read the book. The three diagnostic criteria we use are the clinical presentation of the patient with seizures, movement disorder, and developmental delay, a lumbar puncture showing isolated low CSF glucose, termed hypoglycorrhagia, and thirdly, pathogenic variants in the SLC2A1 gene, which is encoding the GLUT1 transporter. Now, having said that, there can be a combination of these three criteria. Not all of them might be positive, and we developed an algorithm in the 2020 international consensus to make the diagnosis secure, probable, possible, or even outrule GLUT1 deficiency.
The current standard of care in GLUT1 deficiency is the ketogenic diet. And after starting the diet, typically families and patients notice a big improvement in seizure control. My patients also tell me a big improvement in attention and in some of the physical symptoms that children experience, such as fluctuations in balance and coordination, which often smooth out and become more consistent and much improved. We run into more challenges is that as people get older, in adolescence and in young adulthood, a common challenge for people are episodes of paroxysmal dyskinesia, which are episodic involuntary movements that can have quite an impact on daily life because they can occur unpredictably, where somebody will get an episode of involuntary movements that makes them have to sit down and rest and stop what they're doing, for example. It might make people really curtail their activities and decide not to do things to avoid the risk of such episodes happening, so they have a big impact on life. And the ketogenic diet doesn't seem to fully address that symptom as people get older, whether that is because it gets difficult to maintain the diet in a stringent way for many, many, many years, as families are committed to doing, or whether there's also something we don't understand about what causes those episodes to happen. And maybe the ketogenic diet doesn't fully address the underlying reason why those episodes happen, and that's definitely a need for us to look for better treatments.
In our consensus guideline for GLUT1 deficiency, a big part, I'd say maybe almost a quarter of the guideline, focuses on the ketogenic diet and what we know, and really kind of dived into much more detail, not trying to sort of imagine what the ketogenic consensus guideline has, because that's out there, but really, what do we know for GLUT1 deficiency? What's different for a child with GLUT1 deficiency versus a regular child with epilepsy on a ketogenic diet? And so there's some like pretty important changes. Number one, I think we're very clear that the ketogenic diet is the best therapy for GLUT1 deficiency. There are a lot of therapies, even still now, years later, people are looking at triheptanoin, ketone esters, not appropriate. Okay, those should not be tried in children with GLUT1 before a ketogenic diet. And so that was pretty clear in our consensus guideline. We also highlight that children under age 2 should be put on a classic ketogenic diet, whereas on the sort of the standard ketogenic diet for epilepsy, you could make a lot more changes. You still can for GLUT1 deficiency, but we're pretty clear in our guideline that the classic ketogenic diet should be tried as long as possible and switch if there's issues or problems. Try to do blood ketones. We don't usually do that in regular children on ketogenic diets for epilepsy. We just do urine for the most part. But the consensus group was sort of the opinion we should be doing blood ketones. Try to keep the blood ketones between 2 and 5 millimolars. We were a little more specific about that. And then also, I think, which is very different for GLUT1 deficiency versus the regular child with epilepsy on a ketogenic diet, is that there is no end date. Okay? For epilepsy, usually after 2 years, we come off the ketogenic diet, but not the case for GLUT1 deficiency. It's basically as long as it's helpful, maybe into adulthood. So those were sort of the major sort of differences. There were some subtle other differences that we talked about. But again, that was sort of the goal of our guideline, was really focusing on GLUT1 and the ketogenic diet. Thank you.
working with adults who have GLUT1 deficiency syndrome, one of the things that I have recognized is that there isn't a typical experience. That many adults that have glucose transporter type 1 deficiency syndrome may have been diagnosed as children and may have been treated with various therapies over the course of their lives prior to coming to an adult provider for care, while others may actually be diagnosed in adulthood. Some of the circumstances could be an adult who has a child diagnosed with glucose transporter type 1 deficiency syndrome, and in fact they undergo testing as well and find out that they are asymptomatic, however they do have the gene as well that qualifies them for the diagnosis. And so we really do see a whole wide range of experiences for adults with glucose transporter type 1 deficiency syndrome. Now, unfortunately, some of those experiences can be negative for individuals who are trying to transition into adult care and there really aren't the resources available. So one of the big opportunities is to provide these resources with regards to care in the area of dietetics for these patients to be able to receive the appropriate ketogenic diet therapies, not only in childhood, but also in adulthood, as well as occupational, physical therapy, speech therapy, any kind of opportunities that there are for further development in adulthood and support for these patients. This is an area of great need and great opportunity within the field.